Since the topic this week is play, I think both of us thought that a natural person to involve was Eric Rosenbaum, one of the graduate students in our lifelong kindergarten group, who I think has been one of the most playful graduate students and researchers that we've had here at the Media Lab. So we thought it'd be great to talk to Eric about ideas about play and tinkering. In fact, we wrote a paper together about designing for tinkerability, of how we can design things to help other people tinker. I think one thing that I've always been impressed with you is both that you're thinking about how to help other people tinker, but you have a tinkering spirit yourself. So I think it'll be great to hear about some of your activities about your own tinkering and also the way that you've supported other people tinkering. So I thought we might start with having you talk about the MaKey MaKey project that you worked on with Jay Silver, so you can tell about that.
Absolutely. Well, this is the MaKey MaKey invention kit. It's an invention kit for everyone, and rather than trying to explain it, I'm just gonna show you quickly what we can make it do. Here's the MaKey MaKey circuit board. It's a little printed circuit board with a microcontroller on there that it pretends it's a keyboard. So it's a USB device. Uh-oh. Where's my USB cable? Ah, there it is. That I plug into the computer, just like so. And then when I plug in the MaKey MaKey, the computer thinks that I've plugged in a keyboard, like to type on, but I get to make my own keys. And sometimes you get to make keys out of your academic advisors. So, for example, I can take one of these alligator clips that also comes with the kit. I'll take this blue one and plug it into on the MaKey MaKey where it says space. It also has up, down, left, and right, and click. And so it can pretend to be the up, down, left, and right arrow keys, or say the space bar or the mouse click. So I'm plugging it into space, and now I can make something that replaces the space bar. I have this web page open, makeymakey.com/bongos, which does this when I press the space bar. It makes a sound. So now I can replace that actual space bar with something that I connect these alligator clips to. So first of all, I need to connect this white one to the bottom of the MaKey MaKey where it says earth or ground. And then I complete a circuit between those two things by touching them to each other. And that makes the sound. But I can complete a circuit because of the way MaKey MaKey works through anything that conducts even a little bit of electricity. And fortunately, we know that both Mitch and Natalie conduct electricity. So if I hand this blue one to Mitch, and then just ask him to hold up his other hand, now I'll connect myself to ground, and we can complete a circuit by high-fiving. Now we can add Natalie in, and she's going to be, let's see, this drum has the left arrow on it. So we'll plug that in to the left arrow on the MaKey MaKey. And then if she just holds the metal tip of it between her fingers and holds up another hand, now I have an instrument made of two people. So that's a quick intro to how the MaKey MaKey works.
Maybe you can say a little bit, after you started work on this and put it out to the world, people started using it in all sorts of ways, probably a lot of ways that you never imagined. Maybe talk about some of the experience of how other people ended up using MaKey MaKey.
It's been incredibly exciting to see the variety of things that people have been able to do with it. When we first created it, Jay and I made a few examples ourselves at his house in the woods. And so we filmed ourselves, playing Dance Dance Revolution by jumping in buckets of water and making a game controller out of Play-Doh and so forth.
So maybe we should see some of those examples?
Sure. So MaKey MaKey is about making anything into a key. Why use your boring old space bar when you can plug in a banana and make a banana space bar? For Super Mario Brothers, you can play with the arrow keys and the space bar, or take some Play-Doh, put it onto a notepad, plug that into the MaKey MaKey, and now you've got your own homemade, slightly squishy game controller. It really works. When we play Pac-Man, we can replace the arrow keys with this drawing. It's just made of regular pencil on regular paper, plug into the MaKey MaKey, and now you can play by touching your drawing. Why are we filling these buckets with water? Of course, in order to play Dance Dance Revolution. It's somewhat harder to play in this way, but it's refreshing. Here we're making piano stairs that allow us to trigger notes with our bare feet. Everyone's favorite, the banana piano, the human synthesizer. It works with babies. And when the cat sits on the foil as soon as it drinks from the water, that completes a circuit, triggering photo booth to take a cat selfie.
Those are some great examples that you and Jay worked on. I know you've been facilitating a lot of workshops to support other people tinkering with MaKey MaKey.
Yeah, I did a very exciting workshop over the course of 5 days in Holland with some undergraduate students, and here's some videos of the projects that we had by the end. So the Chord Fingers allowed this student to accompany himself as he sang a famous Leonard Cohen song, where each finger triggers a different chord as he touches a ladder. The balloons, when they touch the foil on the ceiling, each trigger a different note. The balloons had conductive paint on them, and they used conductive thread to connect it to the MaKey MaKey. Here, she's sewn some conductive thread into her fur jacket to make ambient fur sounds. And of course, the mini drums, made using the MaKey MaKey box and some foil, Play-Doh, and paper. Each finger of the organ gloves trigger a different sound, and then here's a duet between those two projects.
How do you set up? I mean, I've seen you do it, but can you talk more about how you encourage people to tinker and play? I mean, it's not like at the beginning you said somebody make a balloon, you know, on the ceiling.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, the very first thing actually that we did as a group in that workshop setting was I had everyone in a big open room lie flat on their backs on the floor with their heads in the center forming a ring, and we played an improvisation game called Floor Head Hum, where everyone sings along steady note and you get these emerging harmonies that gradually shift and change. And it was a way for a group of people who didn't know each other before to find out that they could do something together and get comfortable pushing their boundaries and going, you know, right ahead and doing something that was unexpected.
And they were kind of already playing and tinkering with the sound together, right?
Exactly.
So we're able to like pull down their normal barriers to just let them start imagining and exploring in different ways.
They liked that so much, actually, that we did that at the start of each day of the 5 days. But they also kind of tinkered with the whole idea of that exercise. Mm-hmm. And made up a bunch of different musical variations on the Floor Head Hum singing game, like one where we sang short bursts of notes that gradually ascended. Mm. We called that Ligeti Head Hum, a reference to the composer, and a bunch of other variations.
I was wondering if you could say a little bit more about the ways that you set up a workshop to help other people feel like they can start tinkering.
One thing that I think it's really important to do is limit as much as possible the lecture part. So, for example, when I'm introducing MaKey MaKey, one thing that I've done sometimes is instead of even explaining how it works or how you might use it, just kind of set it up for people to come and poke around and try things out. I'm there. I might sort of wordlessly show a couple of things and make it make a sound, but then step back and let other people poke around and discover for themselves how to make it work. That feeling of having discovered yourself how to make something work rather than being told by someone else is very valuable.
What about materials and how you set those up?
Mm-hmm. So I think it's great to have a wide variety of stuff in the room, even if they don't use all of it, just the sense of that wide array of possibilities. Of course, you know, I like to have things like Play-Doh, aluminum foil, those brass brads that you connect pieces of paper with, lots of construction paper, cardboard, sometimes food items. You can use water and other liquids with MaKey MaKey. That works great. So just having as much of an array as possible of different stuff for people to poke around with and try things out is super important. Another thing that's useful for getting at that sense of an open space of possibilities is to show lots of examples. Those can include things like the videos we've been looking at of examples that Jay and I have made or that other people around the world have made. But I think it's also very important to have those examples live in front of you because people's sense of what's possible for them draws even more from what they see in the room with them.
And what about how often do you give a challenge versus make anything?
I've tried out different variations on this question of how much to sort of constrain it versus keeping it wide open. I think constraints can actually be very generative. If, for example, we constrain a MaKey MaKey workshop to the domain of making musical instruments, it's actually an opportunity to try to push the boundaries. I like to call it getting beyond the banana piano. It's important for people to do the first thing first, to make a row of objects that play a sequence of pitches that are laid out kind of like a piano and that all look the same. Of course, you can use different instrument sounds, a different combination of notes, a different spatial arrangement, different objects, but they do the first thing first. And then the question is, can we as facilitators help people imagine the much larger space beyond that and get to something inventive like putting the musical instrument on the floor or making it so big that it has to be played by a whole bunch of people? Or like maybe it's like on your back or it's so tiny you have to play it with your pinky fingers or it's made of something that you play while you're eating it or I don't know. It's a big space of possibilities. And so it's important to have those questions at hand, not to tell people, oh, let's make a musical instrument out of the couch now, but say like, well, what else around you could you use? Could you make instruments out of the rolling chairs? And I'll let people imagine those possibilities themselves.